Good morning, it's the Morning Breeze. My name is Simon Kagwanjala. This is the edition of the topical discussion. And guess who my guest is? A doctor, retired colonel, former presidential candidate, Chiza Besigye, will be sharing with us quite a number of insights on the current state of affairs. Certainly, in the midst of this pandemic that is shaking the world, as a medical doctor, it would be worthwhile picking his idea, his views at the moment. A very good morning, Kano.
Very good morning to you, and good morning to all the NBS viewers, wherever you are viewing from this morning.
Well, we can't shake hands, neither can we do elbows, but I'm glad to have you in the studios this morning. Kano, the world is living in quite a lot of fear over this pandemic. Uganda registered the first case. Quite a number of emergency plans have been laid out and communicated to the country by President Yoweri Museveni. Most of them tend to deal with social distancing, closure of airports, closure of borders, and other measures. Let me pick your take on what has been so far done and whether it really speaks to responsiveness and preparedness.
Well, thank you very much. And I think I have to start from a point of thanking all those who are on the front line of the struggle that we are now engaged in. It's not an easy fight. And whoever wakes up to go to the front line must be, you know, appreciated and congratulated for the kind of spirit of wanting to save others. This is a dangerous infection, no doubt. It's a new infection, so very little is known about it up to now. We have been extremely lucky because came out sometime late last year.
Towards the end.
So it's a couple of months down the road when we have been knowing that there is a new dangerous thing out there that is quickly gathering speed in covering the world. So we have had, quite a significant amount of time to prepare. And so your question is, what is being done and is it up to speed with what needs to be done? Let me first, I think for the benefit of viewers that may not know the dynamics of infections, just explain what infections are all about. Infections, if you translate them into what we experience normally, is really like a war. It's an attack. It's an attack of an aggressive agent seeking to break you down. It's an attack. It's an invasion. Infections are an invasion. And what we do to respond to them is how to defend ourselves against an invasion. And so in very many ways, what happens in infections and our responses quite mimic what happens in real wars, in real attacks. How do you defend a country which is
under attack,
expecting an attack? How do you prepare it? How do you, when the attack arrives, what do you do? These things are pretty much the same. And, so the preparedness can be examined from that point of view. What is it that you do? Now, the first and critical thing in responding to a threat of attack is that you must have coordination that is effective, that is thorough. You must have coordination. Maybe before I talk about coordination, an attack must be looked at two levels of response. First of all, the response of you, the person.
Individual.
The individual. Mm. What happens when there is a threat to the community? What is your role as an individual? And what is your response as a community? Mm. So there are responses at two levels, at the personal and at the community. Now, if we start with the community, which is what we are now more focused on, but critically important is also the personal, you know? So the community must have a coordination, effective coordination, command and control. You must have who gives the command. Let's now move, attack, withdraw, do this, do that. You need coordination. And that coordination the one that plans. So you have strategic planning.
From top to bottom.
Yes, strategic plan. What do we do tomorrow, the other day? What do we do? You must have very clear plans. As I have said, you must have coordinating structures that can implement those kinds of plans. So you must be coordinated from the national to the regional to the district. In our case now with the health situation, to the health facility. Is there coordination and effective communication of the plans? And I can tell you, I have been checking on this over the last couple of days. I've been calling colleagues in the districts to find out what is going on in the districts. And I can say the report is not quite encouraging, unfortunately. Because
the top communicates, but it doesn't filter to the bottom.
So you need the top, the planning level, that then is coordinating with the whole system up to the provider of the service at the bottom, and so these teams must be coordinated. There must be regular briefs. There must be instructions that are clear that go down, which are called protocols. You know, the commands that go down and are clear and known by everybody in the system. This is still very problematic. In fact, I have even seen proactive complaints from the districts saying, "What is going on? We don't know what to do." So there is a problem in the command and control.
That is one of the
gaps. And at the national level, this command needs to be broad-based in this kind of a situation. It's not just a technical thing that you have doctors. No, you need doctors, you need the private sector, because this is a broad-based problem. You need private sector, you need civil society. All these people must have inputs. You must have participation in the formulation of policy and in the coordination.
It has shifted from medical.
It is medical, but involves other things. So, for example, even now, from what I've been hearing, the Minister of Health saying, he's talking about the interministerial committee. You need several agencies to come together. But not only do you need public agencies, the state, you also need private people, civil society. I don't see as yet the involvement of civil society, the private sector, people getting involved. And private sectors, you have been seeing, is very much affected. You are talking about companies closing. You are talking about services closing. You are talking about all these things happening. You need to have their involvement, participation, coordination. So there is a problem of coordination, especially in the districts. It's chaotic in the districts in terms of coordination. What protocols? What happens if somebody gets sick? Where do they report? What are the spaces that have been put aside? What are the priorities what priorities should the medical staff apply in selecting whom to Because if there are very many people, for example, who are getting sick,
you can be overwhelmed.
You'll be overwhelmed. Now, you must have clear instructions on how you prioritize your availability.
Mm.
Whom do you attend to first? So you need clear protocols, which are not yet there. And this I'm talking from first-hand information. Now, so that is coordination.
Mm-hmm.
But having talked about coordination, the war, this war, will need to be fought on four fronts, very important fronts. The first front is the front that deals with the spread, you know?
Curbing the spread.
Yes. First of all, to try and get the enemy not to reach us. But if the enemy arrives as they have now, as the enemy now is confirmed to be here, make sure that does not reach many places, is contained and destroyed. So that
I
is...
think containment has been dealt with.
So that,
the borders are closed.
Yeah. So that is one area, you know, of how to prevent getting and prevent the spread. That is what has been very much focused on by a lot of the communication. How do we stop that? Now, and I think the messages that have been going out, which have been doing so for a long time, you know, from very many corners, from the international bodies, from national bodies and so on regarding the spread, have been good messages. What has been lacking in terms of those good messages is good acts to accompany the messages. Just before I came into the studio, I was watching your feedback from the taxi park, from the markets, from the shops in Kikubo, and so on and so forth. And you can clearly see that, yes, the messages are there, but there are no acts. Some people are, there is some water, but there is no soap. Maybe there is a place where there is no water, there is no soap, and nobody knows who is supposed to put it there.
Someone blamed the chairman.
Now, even where you say there is maybe some sanitizer, you don't know what quality of sanitizer that is. You know, I have seen, you know, people, especially who are in deprived communities like ours, they will always cut corners. I've seen people who give soap, the liquid soap, and it is diluted. You know, they dilute it. You put it and you wonder whether there is actually a lot of soap in the water that they are supplying to you. So, who is paying attention to that? And this is one of the things where the state must be active. You know, not only to regulate, to say there should be soap there, but in such situations, actually to provide the soap for public places, like those markets, like what, you need to provide the soap. Even for private people, I have talked about the affordability of the soap. We must be, you know, and maybe, you know, this particular government is always reputed around elections, especially to distribute soap in the villages, distribute this. This is the time to do it. You know, distribute the soap across the country.
Yeah, but, you know, government is responding gradually.
Fine. So, what I'm saying is, unfortunately, in this case, you must act promptly. Because any delay, these are matters of life and death. And
you don't seem to weigh the cost.
So the cost is there, no doubt.
Granted, yes.
The cost must be paid. You'll pay it one way or another. You'll either pay it by distributing what is necessary, or you'll pay it by loss of life. So I'm saying the messages regarding the spread of the virus are there. They are going. And we must keep them going. All of us. Everybody must serve as a loudspeaker to amplify these messages. But I'm saying that we need to do more than just messaging. we need to make what is needed along those messages available. Let's have sanitizers cheap, abolish taxes on sanitizers, abolish tax on soap, abolish, make these essential commodities as available as possible. Provide it freely in public places. So that is an area that has been sufficiently, you know, messaged, where we only need to add on acts to our messages.
So the messaging is spot on?
The messaging is, because what again must be emphasized is the nature of spread. This is a virus whose spread seems to be now not debatable, that it only spreads through saliva drops that come from the mouth or some mucus from the nose that goes out. That's what takes the virus from inside the affected person. Now, it can drop directly on another person and affect them. That's why we need this distance, so that when I'm talking...
This is sufficient.
Yes, when I'm talking, my saliva doesn't get to you and affect you. Or if I sneeze, those droplets that come don't affect you. So the distance. Secondly, when these things drop on surfaces, if they have not come to you, nonetheless, they drop. They'll drop on the table, they'll drop on the clothes, they'll drop or even on my hands if I sneeze into my hands or whatever. Now, that is how then it is transmitted. Another person touches the contaminated surface. And having touched, takes that contaminated hand or whatever and applies it to the vulnerable areas, which are the thin linings inside the mouth, which is called the mucosa inside the mouth, or inside the nose, or inside the eyes. So you must contaminate and transfer. If you contaminate and don't transfer, you don't get, which is why it is very useful to wash hands many times, so that if you get contaminated, you remove it before you contaminate yourself, you infect yourself. So these messages are getting out, and we must keep them getting out, except, as I have said, the weakness there that I see is facilitating what is needed along that, right, that side. Similarly, when we say people shouldn't move, you know, when we say, you know, if you were working in the market, don't go into the market. If you are doing this, don't do it. You are cutting off livelihoods. Because at the end
of... Inevitably.
Yes, inevitably you are cutting off livelihoods. And, you know, this has affected very many people's livelihoods, you know? And our people live hand to mouth. So you may protect them against the virus, but kill them with hunger. And let me tell you, people are not stupid. Somebody will risk to get a virus because, after all, they think if I get the virus, I may die, I may survive. But if I don't eat, I will definitely die. So I'd rather not care about the virus, you know? So it's
that bad.
Yes, I mean, it's a question of how do you survive?
Yeah, but in such moments of despair, what would be done? What would be ideal?
So that's why it's extremely important, both at the strategic level I talked about, the planning level, to plan for that. You must plan for mitigating, lowering the suffering, the risks involved with the decisions you take. You just don't take a decision and say, people should not move, people must leave their work, people must do this and leave it at that. No.
Having weighed the magnitude of the crisis, planning perhaps needed to be put on the wayside for the country to protect itself.
Yes, but what I'm saying is protecting ourselves, including surviving. So not just protecting against the virus, but also surviving the consequences of trying to defend the virus. Starvation, people are not allowed to starve. So this is why I was saying that, you know, we must consider people who are losing their livelihood for the next 1 month or 2 weeks or whatever you are saying, people should not do this at all. Consider, I have not had that consideration. Consider the interventions. Can we, because, you know, these worker, people who work, contribute to government every day. All my workers, I pay for each one of them to Revenue Authority every month. And they are very vigilant in collecting that money. So whoever works is known by government because we pay into government.
So this is the best time for government to pay.
Absolutely. So now the person who has been paying to you now has been cut off. Consider paying back for him 1 month. We are not even talking about 1 month. Let him see how to survive. I have not had any consideration of how people survive. We must have that conversation at the state level. But on top of the state, since we know which state we are talking about, and I will get to it at some stage, since we know what state we are talking about, we shouldn't expect much from there. Desirable as it should be. This is why I make the passionate call to us, the people, to help each other as much as possible during this time. For the Christians, this is also the Lent period when we should be helping out each other. But if we Lent or no Lent, this is a situation where we have to survive together or sink together. If you don't help me and I go and contract the disease, it will come to you.
We survive together?
Or we sink together. This is the that's the situation. And you know, the problem is our people are now used to survival on each one's behalf, on each one caring about their own survival, survival of the fittest. This is not survival of the fittest. This is, in fact, ensuring the weakest survive, because the weakest will go with you. And I think it has already been demonstrated that this now is not a situation where even the rich will survive. Because even the rich now cannot run away from the poor. We are all contained in the same vessel. So, please,
forget government.
Forget government. Let's help each other to survive as much as we can in this period. Now, let me leave the spread there. So I was talking about the spread. I say there are four fronts. The second front.
You've stemmed the spread.
Yes. So the second front that we must deal with is the front of the individual. Who is going to be facing the individual fighter? We are now talking about the national army. But what about the individual fighter? What preparation do you need to make?
For an individual.
You as an individual. Because again, as you have seen, how we survive depends on what you have also done you as an individual. Very much like the army. In the army, you have soldiers who go to war. How many come back? A lot depends on the preparations of each soldier. Some soldiers, when there is training, they dodge. They make themselves sick. They don't want to go to do, because training is hard. It requires a lot of effort. You know, some people want to dodge hard things. Those are the first ones to die in war. the ones who did not train very well, the ones who have not, prepared themselves psychologically for the fight, those are the first victims. So even in this, even in the fight against disease, how the individual, how you prepare yourself and your family to fight is extremely important. And there hasn't been a lot of focus on that. You know, you are just telling everybody, wash your hands, do this, but how does the person fight? And the preparations relating to that, how do you help the individual to fight? You know, first of all, the information they need.
Which is available.
Which is not available, unfortunately. Which we are not focusing on. As I told you, we are focusing on wash your hands, you know, space, put a space, do this, don't move. That is the first front.
What more do we need to hear?
The second front is if actually the infection comes to you, like that guy, the 36-year-old guy, who has it, how prepared are you to fight and fend it off? That is extremely important. How each one is prepared, how families are prepared to fight.
After prevention, we create a scenario that what if it happens?
Yes, absolutely. And so understand this. Our listeners should understand that being infected doesn't mean you get a disease. Doesn't. There are many people who will be infected and who will never know that I was actually infected. What determines who gets the disease and who doesn't depends on three important things. The first one is how much of the infective agent you have taken in, which is why we should avoid taking in as much, even when you are infected, how much infection have you got? So for example, if you are infected and maybe you infect a surface, I touch the surface and have a little wipe on my eye, some little bacteria, few bacteria, virus may go into my body. But you know, if I was close to you, hugging you, you know, maybe even kissing and so on, it means I'm taking in massive doses of the virus. So that is one. How much have you taken in? And some of the measures we are talking about will limit how much we take in.
Right.
Which is why the distancing is good. The second is how aggressive what you take in is. Again, viruses are not, even for the same virus, it's not equally aggressive wherever it is. So you can have, that's why you have even some flus. Get a flu, but it's light. You get a flu, but it's very severe. So some agents are very, very aggressive. And if something is very aggressive, even if you take in very little, it causes a lot of problems. If something is less aggressive, even if you take in much, it will not cause. So the first one is how much you take in. The second is how aggressive. The third is how immune you are. Your body immunity. How your body is prepared to fight. So once something enters, the body immediately starts, has a defensive mechanism, immediately fights. So how bodies are prepared to fight back is extremely important.
Right.
And that is an area, as I have said, where there has not been sufficient focus. You don't prepare your body to fight during the war. No. So
before the war.
Yes. So soldiers are trained before the war. In fact, there is a saying in the military that the more you sweat in peacetime, the less you bleed in wartime. So sweat, you must do, prepare. Do a lot to be fit for war. If you've done that in war, you bleed less. So now, the same thing. If we have prepared our bodies well during the time, you know, before these kinds of disasters come, determine how much we are prepared to survive.
So in this case, as we take a break, how should Ugandans prepare themselves?
Yeah, so there are measures. First of all, as I have said, the fact that we have not been preparing itself is a disadvantage. You know, so many Ugandans are actually weak. But there are important things, even at this stage, before it comes to you, that you need to do. And I have taken a time, we may not have enough time here, I will continue to air them even on my social media places, what you need to do. There are many of the things we need to do don't need even money. For example, having enough sleep, having exercise, you know, the whole question of relaxation. Stress is one of the biggest challenges to immunity if you are stressed. So managing stress, and that is a complex area that needs expansion. But over and above all those, eating the right things. And I've been talking about especially, and maybe my message has been heard, because yesterday I sent for lemons, and I was told one lemon is now 500 shillings. Lemons are magic. Lemons, not only do they contain huge amounts of vitamin C, but they also have other elements, especially if you use hot water with lemon, it produces other agents that are extremely important in defending the body.
Kano, I'm afraid we need to take a very quick break. We're getting a very enriching perspective from a medical doctor and politician trying to weigh in on the current crisis and what can be best done to alleviate the problem. Let's take a break and return.